So something really has to go wrong for SIBO to occur. It doesn't just happen like from eating too many carbohydrates. I mean, how many people here know people that eat way too many gross, horrible carbohydrates and they don't have SIBO? Yeah, right. So something has to go wrong. Patients love to blame their SIBO on the fact that like they eat too many potato chips, but that's not going to make it happen. Something in the body has to go wrong. Some of the protective mechanisms have to fail. So there's really two main underlying causes of SIBO, and I've got this listed first. The first would be deficiency of the migraine motor complex, of the normal small intestinal motility. So that would mean that the bacteria are not getting cleared out. The second one would be structural alterations. So this would be things like obstruction, physical obstruction, so that the bacteria get blocked, a little non-draining pocket like a small intestinal diverticula, or in the case of blind loop syndrome, a section that's non-draining. So then they get trapped, the bacteria get trapped, and they can't get out. Or a fistula from the large intestine to the small intestine, would that be back migration? Or maybe an absent ileocecal valve. That fistula and absent ileocecal valve have quite a bit of controversy in the studies and the literature, but we can understand the concept of back migration. There's actually a third very well accepted underlying cause of SIBO, and that's frank immunodeficiency disease. Not the kind of thing where you do a stool panel and you see some low SIGA, but frank immunodeficiency disease. And in frank immunodeficiency disease, either the bacteria are not being killed, or maybe they're not being cleared, because in almost all cases of frank immunodeficiency, there's poor motility. I was just telling Steve, I don't know the mechanism, but that's just what happens. Okay, so those are the underlying causes. That's what's gone wrong in the body to allow the bacteria to accumulate. But now let's talk about, well, what are the causes of the underlying causes? So the causes of the underlying causes would be diseases, disorders, drugs, surgery, trauma, genetics, things like that. So if we look at motility, probably if we look at the category of diseases, probably the most common reason people have SIBO is from food poisoning. And I'm going to describe this later, in just a moment.
Wait, from what?
I'm sorry, what was that?
Food poisoning.
Food poisoning, yeah, and I've got it bolded right here on the slide. So the medical term for that is acute gastroenteritis. Other names it's known by stomach flu and traveler's diarrhea. Other diseases that can cause a deficiency of the migrating motor complex are scleroderma, I already mentioned that. Diabetes. Most people with diabetes will have, after a certain amount of the time of that disease, will have a gastroparesis, which is a slow motility of the stomach and the small intestine. And Ehlers-Danlos syndrome. All of these can slow motility. There are more, I'm just giving you some examples. Now for drugs, opiate narcotics, we all know they slow motility, they cause constipation. I've seen a lot of patients that they went in for like knee surgery or some other surgery, they were put on opiates, and then they got SIBO. So that's a common cause too. Now for antibiotics, there's a theory about how antibiotics can slow motility, and maybe we can get to that in question and answer. So surgery and trauma can also cause muscle and nerve damage and decrease motility. For obstruction, the diseases would be things like appendicitis, which can lead to adhesions, endometriosis from the tissue swelling, cancer, the tumors can physically cause blockage, inflammatory bowel disease, there are strictures that can block the passage of the lumen. Volvulus would be that's a twisting or kinking of the intestines, and superior mesenteric artery syndrome. That, I've seen several patients that have SIBO from this. And that's where that artery compresses, physically compresses the small intestine. Now, surgery and trauma could cause adhesions, and I think adhesions are a pretty common cause of SIBO. Adhesions are quite common. Well, I have a slide coming up on that, so I'll just hold my discussion on that. And then immunodeficiency, so SIBO's been documented in HIV, CLL, and T-cell deficiency. There are a lot of articles on hypochondria and proton pump inhibitors as a cause of SIBO. I have just spent more than 9 months reading pretty much all of them. It was really hard reading all those articles, and they are intensely conflicting. And my conclusion is absolutely hypochondria or proton pump inhibitors, which cause hypochondria, are a risk factor for SIBO, without a doubt. But I'm not so sure that they're a true underlying cause. So we can talk more about that later if you want. Okay, so adhesions, here's a little picture showing adhesions within or with or without the intestines. I think outside of the intestines would be more common. Adhesions are almost universal after some kind of surgery or trauma. They form from inflammation, infection, or trauma. However, not all adhesions will obstruct the small intestine. You know, so they may not be causing a problem where they're obstructing the small intestine. So common ways people could get this would be appendicitis or, you know, sports injury or surgery. Okay, now let's talk about how food poisoning can cause SIBO.